Hello, space friends. Captain Snuggles here. Welcome back to what might be the final installment of the X4 Propulsion Lab. In this short series, I've been performing comprehensive scientific tests of every engine available for purchase in X4 Foundations. I've finished the so-called laboratory portion of those tests using numerous repetitions of nice, controlled experimental runs. For the most part, the lab results aligned with expectations and just added some more detailed quantitative info to our existing knowledge. There was only one result that really deviated from community expectations, and that was subcapital non-combat engines. Since about 2019, a lot of X4 players have said that subcapital travel engines are unusable due to their relatively poor ability to escape from enemy attacks. That common knowledge conflicts with all of our recent quantitative laboratory-style data, including mine, which says that travel engines are the most profitable for traders and sometimes even miners. But of course, lab results don't always accurately represent practical use case scenarios, which brings us to this episode. I'm aiming to resolve the discrepancy between our lab results and the community's long-standing advice by providing a quantitative analysis of the trade-offs between profitability and survivability for the three types of subcapital engines under practical use case scenarios. For this test, I looked back at the results of my previous non-combat propulsion lab test and selected the top-performing variants of travel and all-round engines, excluding Boron. For the combat engines, Argon beat Split by 1 percentage point last time, but I decided to pick Split anyway since it should have the absolute best survivability out of all the engines. That gave us the Argon Travel, Argon All Round, and Split Combat as the engines of choice for this practical test. All Mark II, as usual, for a nice balance between performance and cost. I wanted to test them on both traders and miners, and I wanted to look at a couple of different hulls for each of those categories. I settled on the Boa and the Demeter Sentinel for traders, and the Plutus Mineral Sentinel and the Manarina Gas Sentinel for miners. Those are all high-tier choices that represent a diversity of speed, cargo, and defense. I gave them all basic fits, Argon Shields, flak in all the turrets, Mark II gear anywhere I had the option. I also gave them each 20 laser towers and set their default behavior to escape and drop towers when attacked. Very standard, very important for survivability. I tested them in the role of station traders and station miners. Using one engine variant at a time, I assigned 10 of each ship to trade or mine for this station that you're seeing on screen. This is a medium-sized shipyard supply station, producing almost all the resources required for ship production using the universal method. It is located in Two Grand, a nice central system with trade routes leading to 14 ship production facilities and plenty of mining hotspots, with the little issue that those trade routes are all quite dangerous. To the northwest, there's Zyarth space, which is usually full of xenon. To the southwest, there's the deadly passage through Hatikva's Choice. To the south, there are the pirate havens of Teladi space. And to the east, there's Free Family space, including the notorious Fires of Defeat battleground system. I gave my station a 4-star manager, allowing it to cover all the trade routes I just listed, and the ships all have a crew skill of 7 out of 15. Nice and average. I set this up to be both practical and still somewhat controlled. I did that by working entirely within a single game seed. I loaded up the station and all the ships, plus a little bit of supporting infrastructure in a brand new game. To start out, I let that game run for 7 hours. During that time, there were no subordinates assigned to the station, but I did get it a small quantity of startup supplies, up to about 10% of its storage capacity. At the 7-hour mark, I saved the game and used that save as the starting point for my test runs. For those runs, I took all ships with a single engine type and assigned them to the station. I gave the station a small loan of 1,000,000 credits and forbade it from buying raw materials from NPC factions, although I did still let it freely buy intermediate materials. Then I parked my personal ship way out of the way and just let the game run for 2 hours with Sita on, for a total of 12 actual game hours per run. I repeated each run twice. I recorded the station account balances, casualties, casualty sources, and number of laser towers deployed, as well as any major events that went on in the universe. Then I analyzed that dataset to determine how survivability and profitability varied between engine types. Just for a little context on the universe I was operating in, this was a pretty nasty game seed. The Xenon consistently breached the defenses and fires of defeat within 2 hours of the run starting, leading to raiding parties and even K's and I's on my home turf in 2 grand within about 3 hours. Meanwhile, they consistently breached Hatikva's choice between hours 2 and 5. Xyarth space actually held up pretty well thanks to a factory that spawned right next to the family Xen defense station, but there were consistently Ka'ak in family Newt. And of course, Teladi space was full of pirates, as always. So my ships were in constant danger as soon as they left my station's defensive perimeter, as you can see from the fireworks in the background there. Now, time for the results. As expected, travel engines were the most profitable by a solid margin, about 12% better than all round, which were in turn about 12% better than combat. Bear in mind we're talking about net profits here. This does take ship replacement costs into account. So, even considering you'll have to pay some extra to replace your lost ships, travel engines are clearly the most profitable on medium ships with Mark II gear. But how many ship replacements are we talking about? Well, the hourly attrition rates were all less than 1%. Attrition for combat engines was lowest at 0.3% per hour, all round was about 0.4%, and travel was about 0.7%. Those are very low loss rates for all of them, and unsurprisingly, we see the opposite trend as the profitability results. So, which engine is best? Well, looking purely at the in-game cost-benefit analysis, Argon Travel is quantitatively superior. It brings in enough credits to offset its higher mortality and still has a nice cushy 12% profit advantage on top of that. The catch is that the cost-benefit analysis can't be purely in-game because higher mortality doesn't just mean an outlay of credits for ship replacement, it also means that you, the player, have to take a certain number of actions to replace and reassign those lost ships. It's up to you to decide the value of your personal actions. Or, in other words, are you willing to press some extra buttons to get yourself that extra 12% profit margin? I can't answer that for you, but I can give you a little guidance. In the scenario I tested, where I was assigning all the ships to a station, replacing ships takes very few actions. Same goes for assigning them to a trade fleet or a mining fleet. On the other hand, if you're using highly specialized ships with carefully customized repeat orders, those will be way more complicated to replace. And, of course, the later in the game you are, the bigger your fleet gets, and as your fleet gets bigger, those tiny little attrition percentages will translate into larger and larger numbers of lost ships, meaning more actions required to replace them. In addition to those action economy trade-offs, there are a few more things that might influence your preferences here. Are you operating in a safer space than I was, or taking steps to defend your operations? If so, your losses will be lower, which will boost the profit margins of travel engines. Are you using Mark III equipment instead of Mark II? If so, your ships will be slightly more survivable, but every loss will hurt more, so you might prefer a more conservative engine type. Are your mining hotspots within 1 or 2 jumps of your station? The closer they are, the less time your miners spend in travel mode, making all-round and even combat engines much more competitive. And there may be other things to think about as well. Point is, you have to think about the specifics of your personal use case to decide how you want to balance survivability versus profitability. That's almost it, but I do want to cover a few miscellaneous odds and ends before we wrap up. First, laser tower deployment. It tended to be fairly evenly distributed across all the ships, with an average of less than one tower deployed per ship per run, which is an infinitesimally small expenditure. So, buy laser towers. Second, I want to talk about my ship types, specifically the Boa versus the Demeter Sentinel. There actually wasn't any meaningful difference in survivability between the two, which was surprising. I thought the Boa would be noticeably more survivable due to its high speed. And, to be fair, if I did 100 runs of this, it might turn out to be slightly more survivable. But it doesn't seem like it's much more survivable than the Demeter. Now, that brings us to the third and final bit of miscellaneous trivia. I want to talk about the specific enemy types that these engines could and couldn't escape. I did not have a single loss to Ka'ak or to Xenon raiding parties during any of these runs, despite lots of combat against both. That doesn't mean these engines will never lose to those enemies, it just means that they have generally good survivability against them. In these runs, I only lost ships to pirates and Xenon capitals. All engines were equally bad against Xenon capitals. If they tried to dock at a station that was under siege from a K or I, they died, regardless of their engine type. Where their performance varied was against pirates, namely the Scaleplate Pact and the Fallen Families. The Travel engine had moderate survivability versus Scaleplate, and low survivability versus the Fallen Families. All Round had high survivability versus Scaleplate, and still low survivability versus the Fallen Families. And the Combat engines had high survivability versus Scaleplate, and moderate survivability versus the Fallen Families. So, there's another thing to think about when considering your use case. What enemy types are your ships likely to face? And now, I'll leave you to ponder that question and all the other questions I've left you with. I know this wasn't necessarily the straightforward answer that you might have been looking for, but X4 isn't a straightforward game. I hope I've at least armed you with the knowledge to make good, informed, personalized decisions about which engine is right for you. Thanks for watching, I hope you enjoyed, I hope you'll tune in next time, and until then, this is Captain Snuggles, signing off.